Welcome to the 27th Annual Georgia Bar Media and Judiciary Conference, Georgia Judges, Journalists, and Lawyers, and the First Amendment. Today's program has been approved for 7 CLE hours, 1 ethics, and 1 professionalism hour. If you have any questions about CLE credit, please see your staff at the registration desk. Also, please make sure you have your parking ticket validated. Now, I will turn it over to Peter Canfield. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Peter Canfield. I'd like to welcome you to our conference today. We think we have a great program in store for you. I want to first thank our sponsors. CNN has been a longtime supporter of this conference and the Georgia First Amendment Foundation. A number of members of the foundation are always very active in the planning of the conference. And we could not do this conference without the foundation's support, as well as the support of all our other law firm and media and judicial organization sponsors. We planned this conference. It's a long but fun process. We usually start in September. We have a large planning committee. We have a number of lunches at which we come up with topics and figure out who we're going to invite and get as speakers. The members of the planning committee are listed on the program, and I'm going to ask them to stand if they are here now. If all our planning committee members could stand, thank you. I'd like to especially thank Stephanie Wilson from the State Bar, who really acts as the executive director of this conference and helps us with all the logistics. And also Leslie Gaither with Kilpatrick Stockton, who takes care of the materials every year. Again, we'd like to thank both of them. We'd also, of course, like to thank ICLE, which does such a good job with registration and other things. Feedback is important. At the end of the conference, you'll get evaluation forms. Please fill them out. If you didn't get a handout with the bios of all the panelists, please grab one. It's on the table out front. We're not going to go through long bios today, but that will help you, as well as the latest conference agenda. A very short roadmap to the day ahead. We're going to start with our panel on the Supreme Court. We'll have a short break. We'll then do a panel of really distinguished journalists who will talk about all that's been going on with respect to the First Amendment. We will then have a look, as we do every year, through a Fred-friendly type role-playing session at one issue that's been in the media much this year, and that's sex harassment. And Richard Griffiths, who formerly of CNN, now the president of the Georgia First Amendment Foundation, will be coordinating that. It's always very educational but fun as well. Then we'll grab a box lunch, and the mayor is coming to speak today. We're very glad to have her. We had a mayoral candidates forum last year, and at the end of the forum, all the candidates agreed. They promised that if they were elected, they would come back to the conference this year, so she's kept her promise. We will then follow with a session of Political Rewind, which is the Georgia Public Broadcasting political affairs commentary that is done 3 times a week by Bill Nugget. They'll be broadcasting live from here from 2 to 3. And they welcome audience participation, so please look forward to that. That will then be followed by a panel that will look at the state of the Georgia judiciary and the Supreme Court. And we'll end with a gubernatorial candidates forum from 4 to 5:30. After that ends, there will be a reception. If you have time to stay for a glass of wine or beer, that would be terrific. And without further ado, let's get started. I am simply going to turn it over to Sean Young, who is the legal director of the ACLU, who's going to lead us through the first panel. Thank you.
Go ahead and sit. So thank you, everyone, for joining us. My name is Sean Young. I'm the legal director of the ACLU of Georgia. And we are really privileged to have a fantastic panel to start off with here in the morning. And we're going to be covering the First Amendment docket of the Supreme Court this term. But I'm going to divide this panel a little bit artificially into three parts, kind of past, present, and future. We're going to talk about the recent past. Professor West will give us an introduction about the First Amendment trends that we've been observing as of late. We'll briefly talk about some of the more recent cases before this term. And then we're going to jump right into this term and talk and go over the major First Amendment cases of this term. And then we'll talk a little bit about the future and what the panelists believe the court is headed and where First Amendment jurisprudence is headed. And then we want to leave plenty of time for Q&A, and I would strongly encourage everyone to take full advantage of it because this is a stellar panel and you don't want to miss out. You want to get your questions in. So let me briefly introduce the panelists. Paul Smith is the Vice President of Litigation Strategy at the Campaign Legal Center, which works to protect and improve our democracy through innovative litigation strategies. He has argued before the United States Supreme Court 21 times, including in several high-profile voting rights cases. Professor Sonja West is the Otis Brumby Distinguished Professor of First Amendment Law at UGA. She specializes in constitutional law, media law, and the U.S. Supreme Court, and relevant to today's CLE, in her past life, she worked as a reporter in Illinois, Iowa, and Washington, D.C. Please give our panelists a warm welcome. So let's start by talking briefly about the past. And Professor West, would you like to kick us off?
Sure. First of all, I just wanted to say thank you for inviting me, Peter, and it's a thrill to be here with Paul. I think this is going to be a lot of interesting things to talk about. Yes. I teach First Amendment law, and when I usually introduce the concept of freedom of speech to my students, we always have a little discussion about this idea of sort of what exactly is speech when we're talking about protecting the freedom of speech. And it's always pretty quickly that the students can start to realize some of the ambiguities. We often very quickly turn to this idea of expressive conduct, and the students sort of understand that there can be some blurriness between saying, you know, wearing a black armband is speech, but is wearing, you know, a handgun in open carry, is that speech? Maybe not. Burning a flag is speech. Burning your garbage is a nuisance. Nude dancing, the court has told us, is speech. Nude sunbathing in public, probably not, probably just indecency. And we even come across the idea that even times using actual words and symbols might not necessarily end up in the speech part of our textbook. If someone says, sure, I'll launder your dirty money for you, we usually talk about that in criminal law, not necessarily in free speech law. Or, I will paint your house if you will pay me $500. That will come up in contracts class, not necessarily in free speech class. And for a while there, I used the example that if a company puts a price on a product and says, I will sell you this for this amount, that we would talk about that maybe in products liability or some kind of financial regulation course. Well, I might have to start rewriting my notes on some of this if the current trends that we're seeing with the court continue in terms of what we think about speech. The Roberts Court has been a very free speech protective court. I will say, unless you're a government employee, a prisoner, or a student. But otherwise, critics and supporters really universally agree that the court has been recognizing more First Amendment protections in a broader range of areas than what we have seen before. And so the question is sort of, is this trend going to continue? And we've seen this showing up in some cases that have been leading in to this current term. I can talk about a couple and pass it over to Paul. A couple where cases leading up to this term back in 2011, in the Sorrell case, we had a Vermont law that restricted pharmacies from being able to sell information to other companies that would tell them the sort of prescribing practices of doctors. And the court said that this violated the First Amendment right of the pharmaceutical companies. So it was one of the first times we really saw this idea of sort of raw collection of data having the same First Amendment protection. There was also just last term a case, the Expressions Hair Design case, where we had a New York law that told merchants that they couldn't tell their customers that they were adding a surcharge on for using a credit card. They could give a discount to cash customers, but they couldn't say, I'm charging you 3% more as a surcharge for using your credit card. The Second Circuit looked at this claim, and they claimed this violated their free speech rights. And the Second Circuit looked at this claim and said, this isn't speech, this is about pricing practices. Well, the Roberts Court disagreed, and they said this is about speech, it's not just price regulation, and they sent it back to the Second Circuit to analyze it through the free speech framework. That's a couple I have.
Sure, I'll just add a couple more. What we're really talking about here is how the First Amendment has grown into a broader range of controversies than it would have in the past, and it seems to be one of the ways you can identify those cases, including some you just mentioned, as different kind of First Amendment cases, is to look at the array of justices. And the traditional First Amendment case, you would see the liberal justices standing up for unpopular speech, whether it's picketing at funerals or violent video games or whatever it might be, and maybe the conservatives would be there, maybe they wouldn't be, they often would be in dissent. A lot of the cases we see now, we have the more conservative members of the court strongly standing up for the First Amendment, and sometimes the liberals are very much in dissent. And an example of where the conservatives were most aggressive on the First Amendment, another case, recent case called Reed versus Town of Gilbert, about a municipal sign ordinance that had different rules for different kinds of signs and was particularly harsh on what was called a directional sign for this. They were sued by a church that couldn't put up their signs except for a few hours a week, and they had very restrictive sizes. And the court applied like strict scrutiny to this, saying any kind of distinction among signs based on their content has to be has to have a compelling interest and be least restrictive. And it was the more liberal justices who said, well, I think this is a really stupid law, and it's really unconstitutional, but you really don't want to apply strict scrutiny every time there's a law that says you can put a for sale sign in this neighborhood but not an advertising sign of something else. That's crazy. Kagan wrote a very interesting concurrence saying, you've gone a little too far in this First Amendment binge view. Another area where you see this, of course, is in campaign finance, where it is the five more conservative justices who continuously seem to be throwing out campaign finance regulations on the ground that money is speech, most recently Citizens United and the McCutcheon case, and it is the liberals who are saying, no, this isn't really a First Amendment problem of the kind that you see there. So those are the kinds of developments we're seeing at the broadening of the First Amendment.
Thank you, that was a really concise and great overview. Why don't we jump into this term, this current term, and we're gonna spend more of our time here. So what I've done is created a artificial, two artificial categories of First Amendment cases this term, and we're gonna ask Paul to cover some of the cases where you see an intersection of the First Amendment and civic participation or voting. And then Professor West is going to talk about cases involving the intersection of the First Amendment and what I'll just say participation in the public marketplace or the culture wars. So Paul, why don't you kick us off with some of the cases this term about voting and civic participation?
Right. Well, probably many would say the most important cases of the term are the gerrymandering cases. One I argued in October called Gill versus Whitford is a challenge to the Wisconsin state legislative map. They then, in December, they granted review, somewhat surprisingly, in a second case involving the congressional map in Maryland called Benesek versus Lamone. And that case will be argued at the end of March, and we'll find out now, I guess it won't be until June, what's going on with gerrymandering. But the argument against partisan gerrymandering, which could be viewed as an equal protection claim, basically that this is discriminating against one party in favor of the other party, but it is much more often.
Oh, sorry, if I may interrupt, you mind giving a brief overview of what partisan gerrymandering is?
Yeah, I was good. Okay.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Sorry.
Partisan gerrymandering, of course, is drawing district lines in such a way as to decide in advance that one party is going to get much more bang for its buck in terms of votes than the other. So if you have a good gerrymander and the votes divide 50-50 across the state, one party might get 60% of the legislative seats, the other party would get 40%, even though they have equivalent support. So it's a way to distort the democratic outcome. It's been a feature of American democracy, of course, for a long time. It is, however, getting much worse for a couple of reasons. Better technology, better data, and a much more polarized and predictable electorate, so people don't shift back and forth as much. So the question before the court is whether to finally do something about gerrymandering as a matter of constitutional law. As I was saying, while we used to think of this as an equal protection problem, everybody now talks about it as a First Amendment problem, in part because the First Amendment is such a powerful weapon at the court these days, and in part because the person who's going to decide the case is Justice Kennedy, the single most stalwart First Amendment supporter that the court has seen in many, many years. One of the reasons why the First Amendment claim almost always wins at the court is he's for it, whether it's on the liberal side or the conservative side. He'll join for either way. So he's going to decide these cases in all likelihood. The liberals are going to be against the gerrymandering, and it looks to me like the conservatives, Roberts and Alito in particular, gave me a really rough ride in October. Interestingly, though, the issue is not whether gerrymandering, using district lines to predetermine the outcome of elections, is constitutional or not. It's obviously unconstitutional. It is about as naked a form of viewpoint discrimination as you can imagine. The issue has always been one of justiciability. Is there a way to draw a line between excessive partisanship in district lines as opposed to merely sort of politics as usual? And the reason that's an issue is because the court has always seemed to think that if they were ever going to actually draw a line on gerrymandering, they wouldn't try to eradicate partisanship altogether from the line drawing process. The reason being, if you're going to let legislators draw the lines, it's sort of unrealistic to expect them to completely put politics out of their mind, especially when they're drawing their own districts. That court, I think, thinks is silly. But they do have a sense, at least some of the justices have a sense, that at some point it becomes so excessive that it violates either equal protection or First Amendment, which is basically the same argument. It's a viewpoint discrimination argument. So in the past, those claims have not actually succeeded because there haven't been five justices who thought there was a clear enough line between permissive and impermissible gerrymandering. In our Wisconsin case, we've come in now with various mathematical formulae, including the efficiency gap, as it's known, which will allow you to measure the degree of partisanship in each gerrymander, rank them, compare them across the country or back in time. And we were able to show that the Wisconsin map is one of the five worst gerrymandered legislative maps in the last 50 years. So we're hoping that that will give the court some comfort that they can draw the line. They'll have to pick a number at some point about where the line is, but at least that they have some ability to tell excessive versus less excessive gerrymanders. The Maryland case is interesting. The Maryland congressional case, which is not my case, is interesting because it takes a different approach to dealing with this justiciability issue. It says any amount of specific intent to decide in advance that this district is going to be Republican or Democratic leaning is inherently unconstitutional. It's a more extreme theory that basically would try to eradicate deliberate, intentional creation of districts for one party or the other under the First Amendment. And it's actually focused on just one congressional district, which the Maryland Democrats changed from Republican-leaning district, which it had been for many years, to a Democratic-leaning district. And the claim is that one district is a gerrymander, because it was intentionally flipped, that's a gerrymander. I don't know what the court's going to do with these issues. We have our statewide theory. They have their one district theory. We have our mathematical formula for drawing a line. They have their more aggressive First Amendment theory. My view, though, is that they're going to do something, that they didn't take a second case and spend all this time on this. And simply going to come back again and say we don't have any ability to adjudicate these things, or it should remain just non-justiciable. political questions. So hopefully we'll know by June what happens there, and hopefully there will be some meaningful limits on gerrymandering. Another interesting political case is Minnesota Voters Alliance versus Mansky. This involves the constitutionality under the First Amendment of a Minnesota statute that bans the wearing of apparel in the polling place that has any political stuff on it. You can't wear badges, you know, buttons, other slogans on your clothes, anything that conveys a political message. And the state does this sort of in consonance with the rules that exist in most states that have been upheld in the past, that you can't have electioneering within 100 feet or so of the polling place, upheld in a case called Burson versus Freeman. And the theory is that polling places are better if they have, if politics is not carried into the polling place, even if it's silent, even if it's just a button. The challenge is that the law is overbroad, that it would cover all sorts of things that states don't have a legitimate basis for screening out of the polls, that will ultimately be the issue. I don't think there's any dispute that you should be able to ban vote for Hillary buttons from the polling place when she's on the ballot, but the question is what other kinds of political messages that are more subtle and maybe less directly relevant to the election are being screened out, and does that in fact make the law overbroad? At the Campaign Legal Center where I work, we filed an amicus brief saying that the law ought to be upheld because most of its applications are probably constitutional. At the ACLU, they have a very different view of this law. It's taking a position that it's grossly overbroad. So we'll see which point of view the court accepts.
And then the ACLU's.
You know, I've noticed over the years, Sean, that the ACLU doesn't win all of its cases.
I got a job in history.
The third really important case with a lot of political connections is this case called the Janus case, Janus versus AFSCME, the Public Employee Union, which is another case in which the right to work people are trying to get the court to hold that the so-called agency fee that public employees are required to pay to the union when they're in a bargaining unit is a First Amendment violation. The agency fee is the fee that is charged to people who are in the bargaining unit of a public workforce but don't want to join the union, don't like the union. Under a case called Abood from way back in the 1970s, that it is constitutional to require such employees to pay for the costs of the core union functions of negotiating the contract and getting grievances for employees and the like. You can't charge them for the full price of membership, which would cover other things like the political activity of the union or social activities and other things. But there's this kind of this leftover rule that you can require everybody in the workforce to at least pay for the union's main functions. And the argument has been since by these employees that because a public employee union, when it's talking to the government about things like wages and other working conditions and conditions of employment, it's always advocating for the spending of public money. It's always effectively arguing about things that are matters of important public policy. It's lobbying for the expenditure of money that some employees may disagree with the political argument that is being made, even if it's being made at a bargaining table. And therefore, I shouldn't be required to subsidize that political speech that's being made by the union when I may disagree with it. I should have a right to work in this workforce and not pay the agency fee. The conservative wing of the court has been targeting this issue for about 5 years, effectively inviting this claim to be brought. The court has not yet quite held that it's unconstitutional to have this agency fee. It seemed like it was about to a couple of years ago in a case called Friedrichs. And then after the argument before the decision, Justice Scalia passed away, and so they ended up 4-4 on that. But that leaves a pretty clear message of where the court is, with the exception of Justice Gorsuch, who was a new arrival since the Friedrichs case. But most people, I think, would think that he will probably be a vote with the other conservatives on the court to say that requiring people to pay this agency fee is a unconstitutional imposition on them as a price too high to require them to pay in order to have a job working for the government. It's always struck me as actually quite a weak argument, the constitutional claim here, because there's lots of law that says the government can put a tremendous amount of limitations on your free speech rights if you choose to work for the government. And the condition here is simply that a chunk of money is taken out of your paycheck every month. It seems like a much lesser of a imposition on First Amendment rights than, for example, in the Garcetti case a few years ago, where they said basically you can't comment on what's going on in your office while you're at work. Basically there's a complete limitation on your ability to speak freely at the office about matters of public importance. So it'll be interesting to see what the court does, but I think this is maybe one of the most predictable decisions coming up. It'll be a 5-4 holding the agency fee unconstitutional, which will have a major impact on the strength of public employee unions in the country.
Thanks. That was a great overview. Professor West?
So I did not argue any of these cases. I have to say, but if you get a chance to listen to the oral argument of Pauls and Gill, it's really, really, sadly we can't watch the oral argument of it, but
Someday maybe.
I highly recommend it. So yes, as Sean mentioned, the court has also gotten into the speech question in some areas that have some hot button cultural aspects to it as well, including issues involving abortion, which the court can never seem to get away from, and a case that brings up issues of religion and of rights for LGBT folks. And what we're seeing with the court here is that it is toying around anyway with this idea of complicity that it has become more interested in, about this idea that people could, is it a problem if someone is forced into sort of in some way helping or being complicit in some future act done by somebody else that they find objectionable. So first I'm going to talk about a case that's actually going to be argued next month. So we haven't yet heard at least the initial questions from the justices to see where they might be. But this is the National Institute of Family and Life Advocates versus Becerra. This is a case that involves the state of California deciding that it wanted to respond to the proliferation of what are known as crisis pregnancy centers. And these are centers that pop up and are run by groups that are pro-life or anti-abortion with the goal of trying to discourage pregnant women from getting abortions. And more than 200 of these had been established in the state of California, and California's concern was they found that many of these clinics were engaging in what they believed to be either deceptive advertising or even false speech as part of these clinics that were designed purposely to confuse women. So they would do things like advertise that they will offer abortion counseling. They would pick names that were very similar to the abortion clinic that was in the area. And while many of them have no one on the staff who has medical licensing, they would do things like have the staff wear white lab coats, and they would do pregnancy tests and ultrasounds and things that very seemed medical-ish, and then they would at times, and some of them, give either misleading medical advice or even false medical advice, like telling women that their pregnancy was too early to get an abortion, and you know, asking them to come back in a month with the hope that they would delay it long enough that it would become to a point where she could no longer access the abortion. So in response to this, the California legislature passes this law known as the FACT Act, which stands for Reproductive Freedom, Accountability, Comprehensive Care, and Transparency Act. And it has two requirements that are being the focus of the litigation here. If it was an unlicensed facility that had no medical licensing, the act requires that they inform or disseminate information to the clients, acknowledging that they were not a licensed medical facility in the state of California. And for any clinic that offered any kind of women's health or reproductive health medical care, all of the clinics were required to either post or distribute a notice informing the women at the clinic that California does indeed provide, have a public program that provides either free or no cost family planning, reproductive health, and abortion services, and then they had to give a phone number where the women could call to find out whether or not they were eligible. So the clinics are challenging these, claiming that they are a form of compelled speech. And in particular, they are arguing that this speech, being forced to post these notices, interferes with their message, which is that their message is anti-abortion. And by giving this information, they are, the message that they want to speak when they are giving to these women is changing. And they're also arguing that this law is viewpoint-based, which is an issue that has come up in a number of cases involving restrictions on abortion protesters or abortion clinics, that they said this, you would never have passed this law for anybody, anything similar, for somebody who was trying to advocate the opposing view. It's only coming after us because we are anti-abortion. So, again, we haven't heard the oral argument. The Ninth Circuit rejected this view, again, sort of saying this really doesn't belong in the free speech part of the textbook. They're saying all that California wants here is to make sure that accurate information is being given, particularly in an area where we might have something like false advertising or misleading medical advice being given, that the government goals here are important. They just want to protect public health and prevent confusion among the women, and this, they say, is completely in line, well, I guess maybe part of the free speech, but completely in line with other types of practice-related speech we give to licensed professionals or people who are holding out as giving this kind of information. But the juicier case that the court, that I get to talk about, that the court heard in argument in December is the one I'm sure we're all familiar with, which is the Masterpiece Cake Shop versus Colorado Civil Rights Commission argument. And I'm sure, again, you're probably all familiar with the facts, but just very briefly, we have two men who walk into a bakery in Colorado and they want to order a cake to celebrate their upcoming wedding. The baker, who is a self-avowed Christian, who follows other policies in his bakery that are in keeping with his religious beliefs. He doesn't, the bakery isn't open on Sundays. He doesn't sell cakes that have alcohol in them. He won't make cakes for Halloween, which he believes is a holiday that's opposed to his religion. He won't make cakes for a divorce celebration party, which I guess is a thing. So he has these other things. And so he says, no, I don't support same-sex marriages, and I'm not going to make a cake for you. So they file a complaint. The state of Colorado says this violates Colorado's anti-discrimination statute, which has protection for discrimination based on sexual orientation. So at first blush, at least to me, this in a lot of ways seems like a case that is about religion, and that he is arguing here that having to make this cake violates his free exercise clause rights, not to have to do something that is contrary to what his religion dictates that he should do. But the problem is that the court in a 1990 case called Smith versus Employment, Employment Division versus Smith, said that you can't really raise a free exercise clause claim against a law that is otherwise neutral and generally applicable, that everybody has to follow and wasn't passed in any way trying to be hostile to religion or a particular religion. And that's really not the question in this case. There's a little bit of a facts here that some people argue might be a question, but basically that's off the table. So the court, the plaintiffs here, petitioner here, turns to the free speech clause, saying that the government is enforcing him to engage in compelled speech and by making him make this cake for the same-sex marriage wedding. So the oral argument for this case, all I could think when I was listening to this was that Justice Breyer must have been in heaven because it was hypothetical galore everywhere. It was all sorts of hypotheticals, because there's a very difficult line drawing problem here. You know, what does it mean for this, you know, what about the hairstylist? What about the photographer? What about the makeup artist? What about the caterer? What about the wedding dress maker? The people who print the invitations? Do they also all, can they also all say, no, we won't participate in any way in this wedding ceremony? What if the objection is not based on sexual orientation, but it's based on the couple's race or on their religion? Do we have a different standard for that? Does it matter if the cake has words or not? What if it has words, but they've made the same cake before? What if, you know, he made a cake with a Bible verse on it for a straight couple's wedding, and the gay couple wants the same cake with the same Bible verse? Does he still have to write it on the cake? And so obviously this just raises an enormous number of questions, starting from, is this a cake case? It is a cake case. Is this a speech case? Is the cake speech? If so, who is talking with the cake? Is the baker talking? Is the couple talking? Is there a point at which the baker's speech is completed? Once he just makes the cake, is the fact that the cake then shows up at the reception for the wedding a different use of the speech? And of course, what do we do with the government's interest here in preventing discrimination? And once again, the battle here is, of course, for Justice Kennedy, who, as Paul mentioned, is and considers himself to be a very big free speech advocate. And he also asked a number of questions at oral argument, which showed that he has real sympathy for someone expressing a minority religious viewpoint from being forced to do something that they don't want to do. But he is also, as I'm sure we're all familiar, the author of all the major cases involving rights for LGBT discrimination issues, of which, too, he is also particularly interested in this idea of dignity. And he did ask a question at oral argument about whether the baker could put a sign in his window saying he won't make, you know, I won't make cakes for same-sex weddings, would that be okay? To which the Solicitor General said yes, as long as they say I won't make custom cakes, because that was an issue for them. But clearly, you know, bringing back signs, you know, thoughts of windows with signs that say whites only, you know, and things that would be very disturbing, it seemed like, to Justice Kennedy. In fact, he said, you know, wouldn't that be an affront to human dignity? So lots of questions here. I think under any outcome in this case, there's going to be some kind of line drawing. Free speech advocates are really actually very torn about this case. We've seen them coming up at it different ways. People from Floyd Abrams, to Eugene Bullock, and others who are usually all on the same side are seeing this very differently. So it's certainly one to watch.
I just wanted to say, it's interesting, if you look at the last three cases we just discussed, the Janus Union fee case and the abortion clinic case and then the cake case, they're all cases involving compelled speech claims, and they're all cases in which the compelled speech claim is going to be upheld by most of the conservative justices and rejected by the liberal justices, with Justice Kennedy deciding in between. And what you're seeing here is an emergence of a very interesting schism in the court, with the conservative justices looking for opportunities to protect what they perceive as minority points of view, particularly religious minority points of view, from being forced to say things that make them complicit in, as somebody said, the other people's views on these subjects. And there's a perception among the conservative justices that that's a very, very important value that the First Amendment serves, whereas the more liberal justices are like, really, is this such a big deal? He doesn't mind making the cakes. He just doesn't like to sell them to these people as opposed to somebody else. Is that really a free speech issue at all? And so this is something to keep an eye on. I think this kind of division on these kinds of cases are not going to stop happening in the court. I do worry about the cake shop case, because the slippery slope problems there, as Sonja mentioned, are huge. We long ago, way back in the 60s, decided that there's no First Amendment exemption from anti-discrimination laws for businesses. If you go into business, you got to serve the public. If we start opening that up now, it really is going to be hard to draw the line between sexual orientation discrimination and racial discrimination, and what kinds of expressive businesses count. It's not just people doing hair for the wedding and the cakes for the wedding. What about lawyers and doctors? They're all in the business of expressing things to their clients or patients. It is, I think, a very worrisome case, but one where it's really hard to tell what Justice Kennedy will do, because he wants to rule for both sides.
That's very torn.
You know, I think both of you already kind of hit on this. These kind of trends that we've been talking about, can we identify who the likely winners and losers of this trend are, if that's possible? That may not be possible.
Well, certainly, I do think that conservative religious dissenters, in a sense, from some of the mainstream culture that are getting this heightened protection from the Supreme Court are going to get that benefit if these cases come out that way, as I think they very well might. Certainly the abortion clinic case very well might. And this is something that Justice Alito in particular has a strong view about, that people should not be forced to toe the line. And business interests are clearly helped, I think, by some of the campaign finance decisions, which again are decisions which protect the ability of people with lots and lots of resources to dominate the political discourse. Those are certainly people that, that the conservative wing of the court are helping, is helping with some of these decisions. You know, in terms of what happens, who benefits from having some limits on gerrymandering, that depends on which state you're in. Sometimes it's a Democrat, sometimes it's a Republican. So hopefully democracy will be better if we win some limitation on that really odious practice.
Yeah, I mean, I would just say, obviously, Justice Kennedy is the winner, always. right, I mean, you know, the union speech case, I mean, I know who could possibly get hurt would be employees there versus employers.
Well, and certainly there's a political variance too, because public employee unions are very important players in the Democratic coalition versus the Republican.
I mean, the concern here that's been raised is that this would just be the death spiral, the death end, because unions can't survive if they can't collect dues, and who's going to pay dues if they don't have to pay dues and still have other people's, you know, the free rider problem. So there is certainly a political, ideological bent there as well. And, you know, and in the abortion case too, these clinics have targeted in a lot of ways minority and low-income communities and areas, and so we would certainly have women there if they can't get accurate information, who would lose out as well.
This question just occurred to me. If these trends continue and the court rules consistently in favor of conservative religious folks saying they have First Amendment rights to resist these neutral laws, do you see liberal organizations taking advantage of those rulings to resist laws that may apply to them?
I would think they would try, but I can't think of an example
in the top
of my head where it might.
I can't either. The question literally just occurred.
Yeah, I mean, I guess I do wonder. In the masterpiece cake shop, is whether there will just be more of a pressure that if what you want to do is overrule or amend Employment Division versus Smith, and you know, find more room for exceptions there, then that's really what you should do. And to some extent, I felt like Justice Kennedy. I mean, to me, it seemed the religious argument is what really was, you know, getting at him on behalf of the baker and trying to fit that under the speech paradigm is unclear and unfair perhaps, and might have ramifications that go beyond what we're really, because, you know, otherwise a holding could be like, you could have an objection that isn't a speech objection. You could have some other kind of just pure animus objection, and on a pure speech holding, it's not clear why that would be different.
To spend a minute, you mentioned animus, and one interesting thing I noticed about the Masterpiece Cake Shop oral argument was how much time they spent on the animus of one or two of the Colorado Civil Rights, the alleged animus of one or two Colorado Civil Rights Commission members who made comments, I don't recall if it was publicly or in the course of the proceedings, about folks with religious views that
Yeah, was basically just one, I think, who had said, was quoted as a member of the Civil Rights Commission in Colorado, was quoted as saying, it's despicable when people use their religion to justify discrimination.
Right.
And Justice Kennedy found that statement really offensive and seemed to berate the lawyer from Colorado who was trying to defend the anti-discrimination position of the state for that comment, which Sonja indicated shows how torn he is, because he finds he really doesn't think people should be disrespected for their religious views. He really doesn't think gay people should be disrespected for going and trying to buy a product. So he's really torn.
Yeah,
and that could be a potential exception under Employment Division versus Smith, that this wasn't a mutually applied law here, but that would be a way to just kick this case out if really just specific to this case. I just don't think they would do that, but I don't know.
It would be sort of weird for them to go ahead and try to avoid the merits of the case.
Yeah.
Because there's like 11 other cases lined
next
up.
Next, they'll just have the photographer case and the t-shirt maker.
They're all out there. So, because these cases are being brought by groups trying to push the envelope and create more and more space for people to avoid complicity, even if it violates anti-discrimination norms.
Well, it's interesting because it does seem that Justice Kennedy is very concerned about animus, like in Roe v. Evans, when he really talked about how Colorado passed a law that essentially made it more difficult for LGBT people to obtain rights, and then he talked about the anti-gay animus. It was my observation that then a lot of litigators, it was not clear whether that was an element, and then you started getting into intent of certain laws, and so there's that theme that seems to be there.
Yeah, I mean, I thought an interesting part of the argument too was the attempt to try to distinguish this between an interracial couple who comes in and there's an objection to their marriage. And as far as I could tell, the government's argument was, well, that would survive strict scrutiny because the government's interest in preventing racial discrimination is compelling. The unsaid side to that would be that the government does not have a compelling interest in protecting.
It was pretty explicit in there.
Yeah,
brief,
I guess
actually.
It was pretty explicit.
And they basically said, and
Chief Justice Roberts had a part where, you know, somebody brought this up and he got really indignant to say, you know, that you're comparing these people, I forgot the words he used, but it was something like decent people in good faith who have this objection to same-sex marriage, that you're comparing them to, you know, racially discriminatory people, you know, was you know, just really outrageous, and he was very upset by that. So, but I would also think Justice Kennedy, because he does, you know, embrace very much this idea of dignity and equality here, I think does see them very similar, that can be a difficult line.
He, of course, is also the author of the Obergefell case, in which all the language is quoted back, which talks about how there are people in good faith who don't agree with the right of people to have their same-sex weddings. And
that's true.
These religious traditions go back a long way, and he's very respectful of all that. And that language is now being quoted back at him and saying, therefore, you have to let these people discriminate. So it's a very interesting dilemma he finds himself in.
Well, why don't I open it up for questions? And if we get a lot of questions, I might take three or four at a time. So does anyone have any questions? I encourage you guys, this is your chance. Yes?
You mentioned abortion. What, as you look forward for over the next 5 or 10 years, Roe versus Wade's been around a long, long time, what are your thoughts? I know you don't know, but what are your thoughts on the likelihood of Roe versus Wade being reversed in the next 5 or 10 years? I know the difference, you don't know, but what are your thoughts?
So the question, I'll try to repeat the questions, what is the likelihood that Roe v. Wade would be overturned in the next 5 or 10 years?
Want to answer that one, Sonja?
Yeah. you know, obviously it depends on the makeup of the court, and I think there was a period on the Rehnquist court where, for the most part, except for perhaps Thomas and Scalia, even the conservative justices said, you know, Roe is here, we'll just consider all these other limitations on it. But a number of those justices are now gone, and we now have Justice Alito and Justice Gorsuch, you know, who might join with Justice Thomas in thinking it's time to overrule. I think Chief Justice Roberts is a little bit of a hard call to read. I think, you know, he wouldn't have voted for Roe, that's for sure, but he also does embrace a certain amount of judicial minimalism and might not want something that drastic going on his watch, but you know, we're certainly inching closer to having, I think, a majority that would do it.
I mean, obviously, a lot depends on who replaces. If Justice Kennedy's, as long as Justice Kennedy's there, it's not going to happen. He voted against overruling a long time ago. But if he's replaced by another conservative, it's possible. The Chief Justice's, Chief Justice Roberts' overall approach seems to be to avoid that kind of big overruling and simply to have measures to sort of slice and dice things back, and I would think that he would prefer that puts the court less in the crosshairs of a huge political debate. So I think he doesn't like that as a Chief Justice. He prefer the court not to do that.
I agree.
And is that similar to what he did? Or at least what some of the justices did, either in Citizens United or a different campaign finance case, where rather than overruling Buckley, Leo, they really talked about, I think it was, maybe it was McCutcheon, but they focused on, you know, it's not, the government has an interest in preventing quid pro quo corruption, and they've kind of moved away from the government's interest in avoiding the appearance of corruption. Is that an example of that?
Well, they certainly have narrowed the justifications that you can offer for campaign finance regulations, whether it be expenditure limitations or contribution limitations. just to so-called quid pro quo corruption, which basically, since that's already illegal under bribery laws, doesn't provide much of a basis for limiting how much you can contribute or expend in a campaign, setting the stage for what could be a big overruling of the whole principle that the government can regulate anything in this area. But they haven't shown any sign of actually wanting to do that next step. In the meantime, though, they've certainly cut back a long ways on the whole edifice of campaign finance regulation, leaving us in this era that we now occupy, which is the super PAC era, and dark money is flowing everywhere, and largely the work of the court.
Yeah, I mean, this is a trend we've seen in other cases, too. At least for a while there, we had Kennedy and Chief Justice Roberts and Alito often taking us more minimalist route, and we had Scalia and Thomas sort of screaming their heads off, saying, what you're really doing is overruling this case. Let's just go ahead and overrule this case. So even among the conservative branch, there was that dynamic going on.
Other questions?
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah, sorry.
How did the considerations in the partisan gerrymandering case intersect with the requirements under the Voting Rights Act for like preserving majority-minority districts and those kinds of things, which necessarily have sort of a partisan impact on the districts you draw?
So the question is, what is the intersection between partisan gerrymandering and the Voting Rights Act requirement to assure that people of color have an equal opportunity to elect candidates of choice?
So there has been some concern expressed in the past by civil rights groups that litigate on behalf of minority interests in the voting field, that too much focus on partisan gerrymandering may put pressure on their ability to continue to create majority-minority districts, because a majority-minority district in the world that we now live in tends to be a heavily Democratic district, maybe 80 or 90% in a lot of places. Think of Representative Lewis's district, for example. That ends up packing a lot of Democrats into that district and can have some negative impact on the overall fairness of the map. But what we've been able to demonstrate is that in most places at most times you can protect those districts and still have a fair politically balanced map. Generally speaking, the civil rights groups came in on our side in the Wisconsin case and said that we ought to go ahead and police both of these kinds of abuses, both discrimination based on race and discrimination based on party. So I think that issue, while it's certainly been out there, and I'm sure hasn't completely gone away, has largely been diffused at this point.
Well, we have a recent example of something that may bring that issue to the fore. I believe after the Pennsylvania Supreme Court most recently found that their maps were illegally illegal partisan gerrymanders under the state constitution. I had read somewhere that potentially some groups may challenge the map that the Pennsylvania Supreme Court drew as violating the Voting Rights Act.
The truth is, though, if you look at the map that the Pennsylvania Supreme Court drew, it's almost identical in terms of its treatment of the minority districts in Philadelphia. I think while there has been some discussion of that, it would be completely ridiculous. There isn't actually any factual basis for it.
Yes, and I believe, how many questions do we have? Please raise your hands high. Okay, yes.
Has there been any consideration to the ability of the representative to actually really represent constituents beyond the Maryland district in question took basically one county and wrapped it around the entire district control board, which, I don't know how you represent
So your question is about how people made arguments about how certain districts have too many different kinds of interests and are too far flung, and therefore one person can't really represent them. Well, that's a concern that people drawing maps sometimes express, that you want to have more homogeneous districts, maybe all rural interests or all one race or one level of income or something like that. But when you're drawing congressional districts, like in that Maryland case, the districts are so large, there's 700,000 people, it's essentially impossible to have a really homogeneous district. Now, what they did in Maryland, what the case is really about, is they took a very rural district at the far left end of Maryland, and they took a chunk of rural territory out of it, and they drew a long peninsula down into Montgomery County, almost to Washington, D.C., where all the Democrats are. And so they did create a much more diverse district politically and economically on purpose, because the Democrats were in charge in Maryland and they thought they would get an additional district. I don't think the argument is so much that that's illegal because of the diversity of the district. It's illegal to say the plaintiffs because they deliberately changed the Republican district into a Democratic district.
I think you had a question.
Well, I'm still on gerrymandering.
Everybody's favorite topic, gerrymandering.
Yeah, that's like that. I'm just wondering, give me a guess about what the court's going to do. I'm sure you've got a dog in that hunt, but that's a threshold. How will it play? So, assuming the court decides to do something, how do you see it playing out? Census coming up, redistricting, and I know Sean's very much into all these issues as well. How do you see it? I mean, is this going to be all out warfare in the states and after this decision? And should lawyers be getting ready to handle a lot of cases like this?
I'm going to try my best to repeat the question. What is your prediction on how the Supreme Court is going to rule on these parts of gerrymandering cases, and what are the implications of that ruling?
Well said, well said.
As I indicated before, it's a little hard to read exactly where the court is because they took a second case, and it's not entirely clear why they did that, but it's I think there's a good shot that they're going to end up adopting something like our approach, that statewide gerrymandering claims are justiciable, and if they go too far in the gerrymander, then it does violate the Constitution, and they're going to try to impose some limitations. We don't know. In terms of its impact, if that happens, if because of the second case they took, they're probably not going to decide either case until June, which is well into the election year. There'll be some efforts, I think, at that point to try to get some changes made in the maps in some places for 2018, but it may be very difficult. So the impact may be more on elections in 2020, which are not unimportant elections, particularly at the state legislative level, because the legislatures elected in 2020 will draw the maps in 2021 after the census. And there'll be a lot of impact in the map drawing after the census, because the map drawers will know if there's a meaningful constitutional limit, that if they go too far, they're risking having the map drawing taken away from them, as just happened in Pennsylvania by the Pennsylvania Supreme Court. So we may very well, hopefully we will see much more moderate, fair maps than we have seen in the last decade. But there will also be a great festival of litigation for lawyers. There's no question about that.
And I might add, certainly the in terms of legislatures engaging in this practice, we never want to suggest, at least they tell you, that you do what is barely legal. So whatever the court says, you get to engage in bad behavior up to that line of illegality. And certainly there should always be pressure to get legislators to do the right thing, regardless of what the court rules.
Well, it may very well be also not clear where the line is. It may take 10 years for that line to get finalized. And in that period of time, that uncertainty may be very valuable because people will maybe overcompensate, which would be good.
If I may exercise moderator's privilege and ask a question to Professor West, because I want to make sure this is a media and judiciary event, and I don't want to artificially shoehorn this, but I don't know if you had any thoughts about how the media covers the Supreme Court and whether these trends have any implications on that coverage, or what we have so many members of the media in the audience, what would you tell them?
Well, I think when you look at the general of the Supreme Court press corps and sort of how there's always sort of this tug and pull between just covering the court very much as this is the facts and this is what they said and here's the law, and this is sort of the Linda Greenhouse approach. She's master at it, of sort of understanding every brief and this is what happened and this is what they said. And then there's the other sort of take of acknowledging more openly possible ideological and political approaches. I mean, usually often the most you get is Republican appointee or the Republican appointed judges or something. And maybe arguing more what could be going on behind the scenes here. In some respects, Tony Morrow for the National Law Journal has been open more to do this. He's talked about the makeup of the clerks behind the justices and impact that they might have on the cases. And so I think I understand sort of the dilemma, but particularly sort of as Paul laid out, when there really is clearly sort of some sort of conservative ideological role that's being played here in how the First Amendment is being interpreted, I think it needs to be talked about, and you know, how exactly you do that, I can understand it's difficult, but I think we're losing out if that's not part of the discussion, and who the winners and losers are, and if there's a trend in who the court is favoring or disfavoring. I think it's important.
I'm sure the justices love it when the media talks about conservative and liberal members.
They don't like it, though. and of course, they're extra sensitive now because this is the first time in memory that we have five conservatives all appointed by Republican presidents and four liberals all appointed by Democratic presidents. So they also worry that they're being identified as partisans as well as ideological wings of the court. And that's just a concern that the Chief Justice actually asked me about at oral argument in the gerrymandering case. It's like, if we start ruling in these cases, we're going to look even more partisan than we already look. So it's clearly on his mind a lot.
And then they took the Maryland case.
Yeah, right. Unfortunately, maybe because it's a Democratic gerrymandering.
Just to be clear, one gerrymandering case involved Republicans drawing maps, and the other one they take was involved Democrats drawing maps. Other questions? Oh.
Can someone? Eminent
domain and gerrymandering. Is there a parallel between eminent domain and gerrymandering?
Well, eminent domain, for folks who aren't familiar with it, is a constitutional provision that allows the government to seize someone's land, but they have to pay them just compensation. And so, I don't see it, but
to think about that.
Yeah. Oh, you had a follow-up?
Are you referring, the question is about, I mean, are you referring to how the towns and cities tend to go out and get annexation of territory to change their racial composition or their political composition?
Yeah.
That's certainly a phenomenon.
Yeah.
That,
yeah.
That's not quite eminent domain, but annexation, the famous case of Gomillion versus Lightfoot back in 1960 was about changing a square town into a 21-sided town so they could take all the black people out of the town. It was held unconstitutional by the Supreme Court. And that's been an issue over the years in terms of, and many times annexations were blocked by the Justice Department under Section 5 of the Voting Rights Act because of their racial impact. Mm-hmm.
But that doesn't happen in Georgia.
Are there any movements to find an alternative to having state legislatures draw these maps in every case? Who could do this?
The question was, is there a movement to having an alternative to state legislators drawing the district maps? And yes, there very much is a national movement to promote independent, nonpartisan or bipartisan redistricting commissions. It's going to be on the ballot in Michigan. They just passed one in Ohio. There are about six or seven states that already have these commissions. The most prominent one is probably California, which has a very extensive process to try to make sure it's a completely apolitical commission that draws the maps. And I think if we don't win the case, this kind of movement is going to get really fired up. It is hard in many states, though, to do that because you have to get a constitutional amendment on the state ballot. The legislature has to pass it in two successive sessions in many states, and legislators are not really all that excited about passing independent redistricting commission bills most places, most times.
Does that play into your argument at all about the excessive political partisanship?
Sure. No. The fact that legislators have a conflict of interest and have use that their position is the essence of our argument, and there was one point in argument where I said to the court, you've got to solve this problem. The politicians can't solve it. They like the system that we now have. It's in their interest. And so I think I was trying to appeal to Justice Kennedy's sense of having to really help make it a better country, and I think hopefully he heard it. He didn't say one word to me for the entire half an hour, even though the whole case was pitched at him. So, but I took that as positive. Okay. So, yeah.
And Georgia is one of those states. You have to have the legislature approve any constitutional ballot issue. So,
any thoughts about how ruling against agency fees and JANS could affect government contracts, non-government contracts?
The question was, how would a ruling that overturns Abood and says that forcing people to pay agency fees is a violation of the First Amendment affects, I'm sorry,
non-employment contracts.
Oh, non-employment contracts with the government. Well, I do know that the ACLU has filed a case in Kansas. There's a provision in Kansas and in Georgia law that says if you, I believe it's if you contract with the government, you can't contract with the government if you support a boycott of Israel. And the ACLU filed a case in the district court ruled in our favor, saying that was a discrimination in violation of the First Amendment. I haven't thought through whether that connects to Janus or not, but that's what springs to mind.
It's interesting. Yeah, there are a lot of laws about limiting political contributions by contractors, which I think generally will be upheld, regardless of Janus. That's often viewed as one of the most easily defended campaign finance regulations because the obvious conflict of interest between the contractor and the politician he's contributing to. Unfortunately, not conflict of interest. They both benefit from the arrangement if you allow it. Replicate the
Pennsylvania
decision. So in Pennsylvania, this is about how easy it would be to replicate the Pennsylvania decision. If there's no federal constitutional remedy and if there's no state independent commission, the only third remedy is to go sue under state law in state court, which is what they did in Pennsylvania on the congressional case. And they happen to have a very sort of receptive state Supreme Court. They were the Democratic, they've elected Supreme Courts, the majority of Democrats. And it was a Republican gerrymander. I think people will try that other places. How effective they will be remains to be seen. We've certainly tried it in the past, and the state courts have not been particularly interested in getting ahead of where the U.S. Supreme Court is. Maybe if the U.S. Supreme Court once and for all rules that there's no federal remedy, they will. State Supreme Courts in some places will get more aggressive. Probably will be most likely to happen in places like Pennsylvania, where you have a very one party controls the legislature and the other party controls the courts. Which again, makes everything look very partisan, even if it's a matter of judicial payments. Not good, but that's just the way the world is.
All right, I think it's time to wrap up. Thank you so much for
a 15-minute break now until we start our next panel.